from a personal perspective, my wife was working back in our home in Yankton as a teacher's aide, and she'd done that for a number of years. And we finally got an apartment that actually is on Missouri Avenue here, and she had come up finally, and we've been apart a lot, not only during the campaign. To put it this in context, we'd been campaigning for over a year aggressively in various fashions. We come into office after a beautiful and fun event. I had quit my prior job to do this and throw myself into it as the governor's partner. That's what he asked for, and so that's the only way we can do it. But my wife and I have been apart a lot, and I don't like that. And thankfully, she didn't like that. And I was tired of living in motel rooms, although the motels are here, and I've spent a lot of time in Pier. I love Pier. I was born here. So we got an apartment on Missouri Avenue. She comes over the weekend, and then the infamous call came in from the governor that, and this may sound informal to people who are watching it, but we've been friends for a long time. And he said, "Matt, we've got a problem." And I said, "Well, what is it, Houston?" You know, kind of joking with him. And he said, "You've got to come up to the EOC." And I said, "Is that the area that we toured at the Michelson Center?" And we'd gone through all the orientation and everything, but we'd been pretty much stuck here fighting the budget issues. And he said, "Yes, could you come up right now? It's important and I need you here." And I said, "Sure." So I told my wife that I'd give her a call later, and came up, and didn't really know these people, and they didn't know us very well. And so if you can imagine, here you've got your governor and lieutenant governor. People aren't really used to us. They're certainly not used to a lieutenant governor being in any role at all. And the lieutenant governor, who is now the governor, had no involvement in emergencies or anything. And we go into a room, and it's Trevor Jones, who's the Secretary of Public Safety, and then Christy Turman. And I'm not even sure what their roles are, and there are other people. And they're explaining to us that the Corps of Engineers had already said that we were going to have a higher release than normal. I think it was 85 CFS. So of course, we knew about that, but it wasn't in context. And then they said, "Well, we've got a much more significant briefing coming over the phone from Colonel Bob Rook and eventually General McMahon from the Corps of Engineers." Now, I have to put this in context. The governor had established, and we talked quite a bit about, a structure in our office, and one of those structures was because at the time I was the only individual on our executive team that had served in the military. He had me head up and be as part of the team responsibilities, the National Guard with the general, Veterans Affairs and other places. And so we get this briefing, and I actually kept these post-its, and this is how I keep notes when I'm on the fly. It seems egotistical, but I've got a pretty good ego. And they're stick with Michael's notes that are in the back of my my book that I'll carry around and go, if I've got to write a note, you know, sort of, "Matt, you've got to pick up milk," or, "You've forgotten this," but it's also things. And so I have post-its all over, and I had to keep these because these are the two from the first day. And let me read, then we have Colonel Rook on the phone. "Colonel Bob Rook, the rain is about 300 to 600% more of the normal, and the snow melt is 140% above normal. We think that this is short-term runoff now. Long-range runoff will be the snow melt." So what he meant was, we've got this rain that's really the rain event that's pushing, and the long range will be the snow melt from the higher elevations. And when they started talking about cubic feet per second, which is something I understood, I was in the Navy, I understand flows, I have been through some flooding issues, but here is what the colonel said. "We believe the releases," this was I think 25 May, "the releases are probably in the 110 CFS, cubic feet per second, to possibly a high of 120. And then they went through Garrison, Big Bend, Randall, and Gavin's Point, that they thought Gavin's Point, which is my home area that I know the best, the last dam in the entire Missouri River system is there, and then you can go all the way to New Orleans, is 85 cubic feet per second. So we're all sitting there looking at this, and then I have other notes from various meetings. But after that was done, we asked a few questions and then signed off and said, we'll call you back. And we're kind of looking around the room, and everyone's kind of assessing it. We take a break, and the governor goes, say, should we talk? And I said, we really should talk. So we go into a back room, and again, we're pretty familiar with each other. And I said, Dennis, I am very, very concerned. And he goes, why? And I said, those numbers aren't anywhere close to being right. And he goes, what do you mean? And I said, listen, Dennis, listen to exactly who talked with us. We have a colonel in the Army Corps of Engineers, an Army colonel who's an engineer. I said, I bet he's fought in Iraq, and I bet he's been responsible for some very, very tough neighborhood decisions with his troops. And he used the words like possibly and maybe and we think. I have never heard an engineer use those words. And I said, they don't know. And it's not necessarily a fault question. They don't know. So if whatever we're going to do to try to get facts out of this, whatever this number is got to be very, very low, or we should be suspicious of it when we start building whatever sort of defenses. And lo and behold, the next day it changed. And I can go through, I mean, I've kept all of these, but obviously it changed here in Pier and Fort Pier. And all of the rest, the people who documented implementing it, we opened up the Emergency Operations Center. Christy Turman headed all of that. As we worked through all of that, we did, and those people who were here in Pier the most often, put together inundation maps then that were very, very important and problematic to create. The caliber of people we have working for us in state government, our Department of Environmental and Natural Resources, our public safety people, generating these maps, generating the information, getting volunteers, it was phenomenal. And mind you, I mean, my background, one of them was in emergency medicine, but I didn't understand what's called the incident command structure, something you're very familiar with. We were not. And so one of the first things we did is, if you're thinking that you're in a home, what do I have to do to build, you know, how high, what's the actual mark, and what I have to do? How do I get information? And so one of those was an internal document that said, here, this is how high the water could go, and this is Missouri River right down here, and where that water could go just south of the dam here in Pier. Somewhere along the line, about 2 days into it, I mentioned to the governor we had maps up, and I said, you know, the problem with what's occurring right now is nobody is communicating with what happens in the southeast. And I know all the way from Yankton to Sioux City very well. I grew up in Vermilion, I live in Yankton, I've been up and down that river and know a lot of people who live on that river. We refer to them as river rats. And my rat friends were calling, saying, this place is not looking right. And they're identifying past floods. It's their home. They understand what's happening. What are you doing for something down here? Well, the minute it leaves Yankton, it becomes wild and scenic. And the river itself was just like up here. It went in so many different directions over the years. That's where they created the dams. So I said to the governor, I said, I think what we should do is I should go down there and do a tour. So actually, Memorial Day weekend, I went down with Chad and other people that we started, and we did a tour of the whole area with the Corps and went all the way down to the Dakota Dunes area. And people were already fortifying but didn't have information because we didn't have the information. People were very scared all the way. And down there, in contrast to us here, it is not straight away. It's very, very fluid in the sense that there's a lot of turns. There are a lot of oxbows. There's a lot of former riverbeds. There are people that have built homes right in riverbeds. The dam itself had a training dike that pushed the river over, and so there were people living in the old riverbed. So when you have water table coming up, not from the river flooding, but from just the hydrology, we saw a whole bunch of things. We get to an area down in the southeast, and people, when they talk about the flood, they think Dakota Dunes, wealthy area, they can take care of themselves. Or actually, that's not true. There are wealthy, and it was put together for a good portion of that reason, but there are areas down there near McCook Lake and other places upstream that were devastated. Their homes were wiped out. Not dissimilar to what happened here before, you know, the dam structure, excuse me, the levees like in Marion Gardens were put in place. But the long story short was that is a very, very different fight down there. And the governor, I called him up and I said, we have a real problem down here. And the problem is that the local development group for the Dakota Dunes was starting, and they were way ahead, but starting to build a levee right on a very fast part of the Missouri River, and all they had were bobcats. We'd already done our math and knew really what our time frame was for a potentially 150 to 160 CFS out of Gavin's Point, which is a very narrow gate dam in contrast to what we have here or Fort Peck. And I said, you know, the minute that comes out of here, this is going to inundate all of it, because there's a reason they call it the dunes. I mean, it was all dunes growing up, sand dunes from the river. And they created this around the river, and as it came through, we started doing the math, and I said, there is absolutely no time unless we embark on a mechanism here to build around the entire Dakota Dunes area, sort of a circle of levee. And I said, I just don't think I should come back. And he ordered me to stay. And then, even though it's not incident command structure, he said, you need to command that whole area and make sure that our incident team is doing what you think is right. So, long story short, we had daily meetings all the way down there. Again, we've lost a number of homes. We had helicopters. We got Terry Branstead from Iowa loaned us a couple of helicopters to use to put in large sandbags in various areas. It was a war zone, and I flew it a few times, and the amount of water that was coming down created potential maps like this, and we had a lot of maps that created inundations, and it's hard to see, but the various colors are actually, this is the river as it's going into Sioux City, Iowa. And so as it comes around these corners, we had various inundations on what would happen with various levels and how we would, you know, what the problems might be because of water levels. And we had them here, where waters would come up in the basement even though we had levees, because of water table. Well, one of the major issues down there is this is a huge oxbow. Oxbow being a former place where a river would want to go. So as I joked with Colonel Rook, and he and I talked quite a bit, and I took other Army people up, I said, you know, you Army guys do not understand water, even though you're Corps of Engineers. I said, the river is going to reclaim itself here. You might understand other rivers, but the river is going to want to go where it was before. And lo and behold, north of that is what exactly started to happen. At the same time, on another side over here is another river called the Big Sioux, one of the largest inland rivers in the entire nation. And if you have backup pressure on that, we could be essentially backdoored in the community there. So we had very, very little time to do a lot, and the whole team worked very well. Actually opened up a new exit. I called it exit 1/2 instead of 1 mile. And there were a lot of things that happened that were the hand of God. Probably the biggest one was there was only one place where there was the quality of dirt and clay to build these levees, especially in a bowl. And it was 4 miles away, and we weren't sure that it was going to work. And it turned out to be the perfect amount and the perfect placing and the perfect timing. And so we essentially closed those roads down and went for 3, 4, 5 days essentially bringing a truck every half a minute. And it's amazing, nobody died. You know, the biggest risk, as you know from your background, is not people dying from the actual event, but it's the collateral, like a vehicle going into the water that's dumping, or somebody playing with the electricity, and that was a really big issue. We had daily meetings, and the daily meetings involved trying to dictate off of this map where we thought the water was. And my right-hand people, including Nathan Sanderson, Randy Hartley, who was a major, and we had a whole bunch of National Guard people that were helpful. We would review what was going on, what would be boiling up into the community. We evacuated as many people as possible. The electricity had to go out because, of all things, their electricity down in that area had exposure to the water because of the way their cables were done. So every day we met and went through my agendas on how the infrastructure was doing, how we were securing the water plant, the electricity, were people being safe, and these are my my notes, all of from that through the middle of June, that I will always keep because it documented how we progressed to a stage where the people down there, we created maps. We were sitting around and say, we've got to create the maps to make sure that these areas, that this is the river, and what are the levels of water all the way down there. And about a week into creating this, we determined that this was actually, could turn into a swimming pool if you didn't pump the water up over, you know, about 10 feet over. And so part of the discussion was, how do you meet the math of getting the right amount of water out without creating the pressure outside that could essentially collapse the levee? Interesting science plan. And so immediately called up people who were from the hydrology team from South Dakota School of Mines and Technology, and they did the math for us. They all come in, it was so cool. And here were all the core people and everything, and they're up there taking us through, well, that math class really paid off. And it worked beautifully, but at the same time, we needed to monitor how deep the water was, because you had different places. And it, and they, nobody said they could do this, it sounds egotistical, but I said, you gotta be kidding me. We can determine if there's tsunamis coming in the Pacific. There's got to be some way to do that. And the engineers from HDR, who were amazing, said, well, yeah, we can actually put and do remote sensing on levels. We'll just do that. And so they dropped them all the way around. And that gave us ideas where there was going to be weak boiling, in other words, water coming up from inside that we needed to attack. And we had these rapid response teams. And at the same time, this was the whole levee. So as you walked around, this was the whole levee of this community. There were others up that I'm not going to bore people with, but it was very hard. The National Guard supported them in protecting their communities. But this one, the intensity of this was then it was created and then monitoring it, just like here in Pier, is making sure that people wouldn't go in to areas that were at risk. In addition to that, what happened here is there's a lot of crime in the Sioux City area. And we had a couple of incursions where people brought boats up and were trying to get in and break into homes. And so we had patrols that were established for a couple of reasons. The main one, security. The second one, if there was going to be a levee breach, you know, to kind of alert a fast response team to go ahead and lay what's called riprap down. And so they would come, and we had probably the biggest event during that time was, the reason that I brought this is twofold. One, this is incredible riprap, what we brought in, you know, thousands of tons or whatever the number is to this. And down here in probably one of the most vulnerable areas because the water was hitting it, it was very early in the morning. I got a call from the incident commander saying, sir, what we have here is there was an individual who believes that there's a failure of a levee down there, down south, and we called it sectors. And I said, oh, I gotta get down there. So we go down there, and a young airman, she had walked by that at about 5 in the morning, and had heard a noise, just a little noise, and went back and said, this doesn't make any sense. Put a flashlight on it, and all of this riprap had slipped off of the base of the levee. And she said, this isn't right. She called the rapid response team and her sergeant. She saved that levee, because a half an hour later, the levee would have tanked. We're down there. I get on a boat, and we go down. We get down there and look. And the water had come around that corner, and over, there's so much turbulence, it had created an eddy, and that eddy went down close to 70 feet. And it had undercut the entire shelf there. And it was, we were only about an hour away from that whole levee breaking. And it would have flooded all the homes and it would have been done. And because I use this example that you can have all these brains and you can do all the math, but it's the vigilance and one person who was empowered to say, hey, this just doesn't feel right. And we changed things after that. We painted lines on the water on the riprap. We did a bunch of other things. But I got down there again with the Army guys from the Corps of Engineers and I said, you guys don't understand this river. I said, I'm running on no sleep, but you don't understand it. And so I'm taking them all and up down the riprap and trying to tell them that when this water comes over, it eddies. And I said, take a look. And I looked out there. I said, we've been on oceans. And there was a riprap, Patrick. There was a rip current in the middle of the Missouri River because of the gradient confluence. And at the same time we figured out what was happening there is there actually was an underground marina, an underwater now marina, that was creating even more turbulence. So it brought in and created this shelf that saved that entire area. Two other points from what we fought down there is it was amazing the amount of debris that came down. So we would fly up to my home at Yankton and you would see the water coming down the lake. And if you can imagine, this is at least happens in my shower. When I take a shower, I look down and there's this trail of hair that's come off of my head in a line that goes to the drain, right? So we're flying on the Blackhawk up there, and here on the Nebraska side, which is where the dam is this line for 4 or 5 miles of debris, of logs, big logs shooting all the way, and they're catching them up there in the dam, and they created a 5-story mountain of all of this debris that was pulled down by that force. Well, the same thing down below, before the Corps built dams, they created essentially anti-erosion mechanisms, which are these very large posts or pilings, and they sit like this. And as you go down south, they're all over that river. In fact, an interesting fact, in Yankton, there was a prisoner of war camp of German prisoners during World War II that were evacuated to that. And they did a lot of that work. And so if you're down in my home area, these are on the river and you see them all the time. Well, the force of that created these projectiles and things were coming down the river at great force. I mean, it was like 35 knots, that's 40 some miles an hour. And if that current was headed towards anything that was, it would have shattered the or impaled the anybody in there, could have killed them, could have done anything, and obviously just the turbulence. So there was a lot of stuff then that people who lived around the river there was inundated, and so a couple of pictures of things that I kept, and so every day if there was a fun story, even though this wasn't funny, it was people sitting there, sir, we've got to show you what happened last night. So early in the morning they show me what they pulled up the day before, and this is used to be a tanker system over during World War II of flyers in Sioux City. And in actually Sioux City and North Sioux City. So this is an old gas tank that would have been on one of the old World War II planes that somebody had at one of their fish camps upstream somewhere. So this thing comes shooting down. And so they're proud of that. Probably the most proud that they are, and it just really shows you that God created people with different decision-making capabilities or lack thereof. I could not believe this, but they called me right away. Again, it was like 5:30, and they said, you've got to come down here. So we come down here, and they actually showed me the physical boat. And this is a baby pool. And this is a story I'll tell in my nursing home bed, for sure, to anybody that wants to listen. So that is a very large baby pool. And I said, so what's the story here? And they said, well, you see in the middle of that is a backpack. Said, last night we heard a noise, and what happened is we have what was called swift water out of Sioux Falls. Amazing people. I don't know if you've ever seen them, but they are phenomenal. So they're part of fire and rescue, and they're trained in swift water rescue. And so at night and during the day, they're going up and down to make sure that people are safe. And they heard this noise. They found a gentleman rowing himself down the river, which would be just steering because it was going so fast. He was in here. There was ice around there. He had ice in beer in here, and he was obviously beyond making decisions. He had chemically altered his decision-making capability. And so they arrested him or rescued him from that because he said, oh, I just thought I would go out for a little ride because the river was going so fast. I have no idea what happened to him after that, but as one of the thank yous that we bonded on, they actually, this one was evidence. So as I left the command in middle June, they gave me a little baby pool that said the USS Michels. And so they presented that with me with a thank you. So my joke to them that next day was, this was the guy that they arrested. His name was Gene. I can't tell you his last name, but it just goes to show you that there's a problem with the Gene pool. Get it? So. But it was a war. One of the things we talked a lot about is in any emergency, and frankly, as an emergency department nurse and other things I'd seen around the world that were tragic, what people need is to be reassured that they're safe. And, you know, I would tell him over and over, I said, you have to pretend like you're talking to, and it's not even a pretend, people you love, and explain, we're doing our best. This is what you should do. And you and other people in the media, with social media especially, really helped get these words out and eliminate a lot of the misunderstandings. But there was a lot of turmoil and a lot of hurt, and people lost a lot of things, but not lives. One of the things he said is, since I had, going back to like 2 days into this fight where we were still up here, I called up Karen and I said, I think you're heading home. And I hadn't seen her for a day and a half. And she said, well, we're out here sandbagging. And so she and everybody have been sandbagging the apartment that we live in and helping other people. And she goes, I'll go home after the place is taken care of. And I said, that's great. And so she headed back, and then I didn't see her for a week or so when we got down there. And then I was just back and forth all the time to the southeast. So after it was all stabilized, Dennis said, well, why don't you stay on the guest side? Come back, and you can stay on the guest side of the mansion. And I said, well, that's cool. And so I come back in, and I haven't been here for a month. And I didn't have any protective service detail or anybody. I just drove in because I had my materials, but I didn't have any clothes. So I go into the apartment, but the last time I was in the street area down there on Missouri Avenue, the checkpoint was somewhere else, and I couldn't see where the checkpoint was, and I was in a hurry to get up here. Governor and I had a couple of meetings with, of all people, FEMA. And so I said, well, I've got to just run in and get my stuff. So I go running in and go around a barricade on the east side, strike that the west side. And I come out, get in my car and throw everything, and I start going back out, and all of a sudden I'm intersected by in a Border Patrol vehicle. The guy gets out and he puts his hand on his belt and he goes, well, what the hell are you doing? And I said, this is my house. I needed to get some stuff. He goes, don't you know you're not supposed to be in here? And he's really working me over. And I go, yes, sir, I'm sorry. I didn't know where the checkpoint was. I just needed to get clothes. Here it is. You know, you're keeping our place safe. And he just looked at me with disdain, which he should have. And he just said, don't ever let it happen again. And I said, yes, sir. So I come up here, I get all my gear, and we go through the meeting, and then I go, well, you know, I've forgotten a few other things. So I go back, and I figure out where the checkpoint is, and it's like a block and a half away east. So I come back and I give him my ID, and he looks at it and he goes, oh, and he starts shaking. And he goes, oh, I'm sorry, sir, I didn't know. I said, no, I'm the one who should be sorry. I'm not gonna tell you why I did that, because it wouldn't make sense. And so he, you're doing your job. You kept our place safe, you don't know. I said, you're doing your job. And he looked at me and he said, I've never been in a place like this. And I said, well, what do you mean? He goes, well, I come from down in the El Paso area, you know, where we're fighting drugs and illegals and all of that. And I said, well, what do you mean? He goes, well, if I'd done this to any sort of official down there, they would have had my job. And I said, you're keeping us safe. I made the mistake. And he just shook his head and he goes, I also want to tell you something that would never happen down there. This is my first day on the job. And he goes, and I go, well, that's cool, officer. And he said, I'm standing out here, and the woman across the street there brings me this morning chocolate brownies. He says, that doesn't happen on the Rio Grande. I said, well, you don't know how happy we are that you're keeping us safe, and that's the biggest part. What I will say to you is that the flood, I think, without a doubt, in talking to people both here and all the way downstream, has changed our lives for those of us who lived through it, especially the governor and me and people and our families and those who lost properties and were displaced. And there are a lot of people that haven't recovered. There are a lot of individuals that I know who still need behavioral health support. They lost their homes. No, they didn't lose lives. And I think that that's one of the most beautiful things and was our primary goal, and always is in any disaster. But on a personal level, it was life-changing for me. I was up and down, and here I was so bloviating about my knowledge, and I just overdid it. And actually turned out that all of my running around, especially on riprap, and that I ended up injuring my back severely, and didn't know the full extent of it because of running predominantly on riprap, they decided. And so I went through essentially a couple of years of hell, not figuring out what was happening. Long story short is I had 3 years ago last month extensive back surgery. And I remember fighting then just 2 years ago the other flood of the East River part involving the Big Sioux. And I actually had a flashback, and had one of my protective service officers, the highway patrol, pull me back and say, you know, you can't be doing this anymore. Karen will kill us. We don't really care about you, sir. So, and there is absolutely no doubt that it brought me closer to God. It brought me closer to understanding the limitations that I have physically. It also altered a lot of what I did in terms of this job in modifying my travel. And the governor and I talked a lot about that it really has been life-changing. In addition to that, I made lifelong friends. And there are people to this day, especially in public service, that reinforced. They taught me a lot. People who were pretty quiet, people who would come and whisper in my ear that at least they trusted me. And there were people of all walks of life in public service, and they all came together, and we were South Dakotans. We took care of each other. And a lot of times I'm asked in our national association to talk about what we do in terms of threat responses, and I, fortunately or unfortunately, either the governor's been gone or I've been intimate in all of them. The one thing is that makes it easy is the caliber of people who are first responders. Department of Public Safety, Christy Terman at the time, and now Tina Titzy, and all of those people that work with local individuals on emergency response that we just take for granted. And I think it's very, very important to also recognize the leadership that we had here among what I would call our young people in the governor's office that then decided, appropriately so, that all of us and everybody that comes on board within the governor's office goes through incident command system training. And we were the first office in the nation, the governor's office, that went through, there's various levels, as you know, we went through level four, and we are the only governor's office. And so I take an opportunity whenever I'm in public settings talking with public officials, if they don't know who their emergency response people are, if they've never been through a tabletop exercise, do it. And what came out of that, actually, our experiences, was we did a joint exercise then with the state and the people of Sturgis. And in the last 2 years, we have worked more cooperatively, and that'll always now be the way because of joint planning, joint training, and it's not in little separate pockets. And we have included our military, we are going to have these events, but we're prepared for them. But more importantly, individually, we just have to know and be aware of the threats ourselves. One of the interesting things I learned from talking to people in Katrina, and my brother, who's a colonel in the Army, had been down there during all of that, it was how people are raised. And he said, people were waiting for the government to react. That's not South Dakotans. We took action. South Dakota provided assets. People within South Dakota Public Service provided that information. And we provided a lot of direction and involvement and assistance. But we weren't relying, those individuals weren't relying on, oh, I'm waiting for the federal government to show up, or I'm waiting for the helicopters. That's how we're raised. And if we weren't, I think we would have lost more lives, and we would have had more injuries. And thankfully, we haven't. So it is an incredible piece of that, of course, that you're going to be talking with people is, what are they doing about monitoring, remediation, and those type of things. What we're doing is we believe that we're going to have more very significant rain events in shorter periods of time, like that which resulted in the flood of the Big Sioux the last 2 years. As you're taping this, it wasn't too long ago that in Houston they had a lot of flooding, and a lot of flooding occurred because of these massive rain events, but also in areas where urban planners had not calculated the runoff and not the ability to soak. And we're going through that. The legislature approved that kind of modeling software for East River, specifically the flood zones in the Big Sioux Basin, which goes all the way up and of course has a significant history of flooding. And so there are a lot of good things that have come out of that. What we call, and you're familiar with, after action work that not only included getting funds out of FEMA, but also how we can get better. What I found is, like in everything, that when we're all scared and when there's tragedies, that there's a vacuum of leadership. And I had a lot of leaders with me, but I've never had a problem making a decision and being responsible for it. I've made wrong ones, but more often than not, when you've got such good people around, that was a high point for the people of that area, because that would have been 500 families that would have been evacuated. And I think the overreaction piece is what we do as a government. It is not what South Dakota does, but a lot of other places do. So I think the other highlights were when people were able to go back into their homes.